when you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality? Who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on ENERGY STAR qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
Hi, I'm John Mallis. Welcome to this live edition of Connect with Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV. Got kind of caught off guard there. Anyway, they gave me the 5-4-3-2-1 a little too quick today. Anyway, today's program, we have the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies on, 436-ME-TV, option 11. I will catch my breath in just a moment, my friends. Back in just a moment after this brief timeout. That brain lapse there just for a moment. A brain freeze is what it was. Anyway, welcome to this live edition of Connect with Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV. It's Me TV Fresno, of course, every Monday through Friday, live at 10 o'clock in the morning until 11 o'clock in the morning. A lot to talk about. The owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. Hey, what are you going so fast for? I'm not ready for that. Anyway, you got a brain freeze too. See, hang on. Got to talk about some programs coming up later this week. And that is tomorrow. We have a politician in the House. His name is Jeremy Pierce. He's running for City Council District Number 6. And he is going to talk about a lot of issues. And one of the issues that he will talk about is the baseball stadium in downtown Fresno. He'll talk about the Fresno Grizzlies. As you know, he's running against Gary Bredefeld and Holly Carter in District Number 6 for City Council. And then later in the week, we're going to have two more politicians on Friday. We'll have someone running for Fresno County Supervisor District Number 3. And then Doug Vagan will be here. He is running for mayor. And top of mind, you know, some of these candidates, three specifically, are really taking a pounding because three candidates running for office this year here in the Central Valley voted for the downtown baseball stadium some 15 years ago. And so they're taking quite a pounding for that. They're having to kind of defend themselves for that vote. You know, Sal Quintero, Henry Perea, Dan Ronquillo, they were all there voting on the stadium. Bredefeld, too, was there voting on the stadium. And so these are prime candidates running for office again this year. Anyway, time to get to it now. Comcast Channel 375, live as usual, Monday through Friday. If you don't have Xfinity, you can watch us on over-the-air broadcast with a digital antenna, 43.6, 13.1, it's not a problem. And you know what? If you can only watch a portion of this program today, say 15 minutes, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, you can catch the broadcast, the rebroadcast at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 U2, 8 o'clock tonight, 4.6 Biz TV. And of course, you can catch us 24/7 on our YouTube channel once this program airs live on Comcast. Boom, it's on YouTube. 24/7, 365 days of year. All right, as mentioned here, one of the biggest issues facing some of the candidates in this year's election is the downtown baseball stadium, despite the fact that they are national champions. Who are they? The Fresno Grizzlies. Let's roll the videotape and I'll show you what I'm talking about, my friends. Some believe that Chukchansey Park is costing the city too much money. There it is right there. And they are pointing to three candidates, as I mentioned, running for office this year that voted on that baseball stadium 15 years ago. Fresno Grizzlies moved into the Chuck in 2002. At the time, they cut the deal with the city to pay $1.5 million in rent. But the financial woes over the past decade or so have forced the team owners to ask that yearly rent be cut in half. And so now the team is paying $700,000 a year to play ball there. The city is on the hook for the rest, about $2.7 million a year for the next 17 years. That's what it will take to pay it off, the bond that is, over the course of time. In the end game, the city of Fresno will have paid $104 million for that baseball stadium. That's with interest, and that's the rub, my friends. Some say it's too much money. Henry Perea, Gary Bredefeld, Sal Quintero, they're all running for office. They voted for this baseball stadium. And then there is the issue of the builder and developer of Terrence Frazier, who wants to enhance the center field area. It's beyond the center field wall with a high rise full of businesses and retail and also housing. Hey, live in our studio right now is Chris Cummings. He is the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. Glad to see him here back on our show. He's here to talk about the financial situation of the team. Has the city done enough to really support the Grizzlies and Chris Cummings and help them financially? 436-ME-TV, option 11, or in your opinion, has the city done enough? Well, we want your comments. We want your feedback today. You can call in, ask Chris a question. No sponsor on the program today. We're back here on Connect With Me on ME-TV Fresno on this Business Tuesday.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Frigidaire Gallery appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy.
Time for that upgrade to an Energy Star qualified French door Frigidaire Gallery refrigerator.
Quality appliances for the way you live. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise.
Not sure what you're watching? Want to see what's coming up next? Or just want to browse what's on without the hassle of flipping channels? Your wish has come true. Now you can view schedules for all the digital TV channels available in the Central Valley. Get local weather updates and forecasts, and listen to nationally syndicated Biz Talk Radio, all on KVHF 4.1. Rescan your TV now, then tune in to digital channel 4.1 to start enjoying the all-new TV guide.
Back here on the program, my friends, I'm glad you're here. Glad Chris Cummings is here, owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. Congratulations on a great year last year, 2015. Boy, that's going to be etched in your brain for a long time, huh?
Absolutely. That was, you know, it was very cool when the Giants won in 2010, 12, and 14. And our players had a lot to do with those wins. But it's a heck of a lot different when it's your team that makes it all the way through for the first time in history. And I was very proud of the players and the staffing that we have, and the world championship ring that we have right now. Let's see.
That camera right there.
That camera, you probably can't pan in enough on it, but it's a beautiful ring. We gave these rings out to the players about a week ago and to our staff.
And the coaches.
And the coach, our staff got them on Friday.
And really?
Now I'm creating a commotion because of the need for a close-up.
You want a close-up of that ring, and there it is right there. There it is right there. It looks very similar to the Giants championships rings of 2010, 12, and 14. Right. But let me ask you something. How many diamonds in that thing, by the way?
Oh, I think it's somewhere in the range of 70 diamonds.
70 diamonds. And what's the cost of making just one of those, would you say? Venture to say, well, off the top of your head.
There are several different varieties of the rings.
Oh.
Most of the people received a ring that's very affordable that we could actually get without a whole lot of help. And understand that the league makes a contribution to the rings, as do the Houston Astros, so the burden isn't totally on us.
Yeah. So go ahead.
But the net effect, we had a positive cash flow for the playoffs, and essentially that positive cash flow was reinvested to purchase the rings for everybody.
Hey, let me ask you something. Let's roll some videotape. You can roll it sound under of the celebration in the locker room. And just kind of tell us what it's like before we get into the hardcore questions.
No hardcore questions. This is baseball.
But I want to talk to you too about the financial part, about your team and what your investment is like, and if you're looking for investors. But we'll get into that in just a moment.
Sure.
But the celebration, and we can't hear the sound on this, but the viewers at home can hear this. Where was this, and what locker room was this? What stadium?
This was our locker room at our ballpark.
This was the Chuck then, huh?
This was the Chuck.
Okay.
And as you can see from the plastic that lined the room, we were prepared for the onslaught of liquid. Fortunately, the carpeting was scheduled to be replaced during the off season, so that was already pre-programmed.
Uh-huh.
But at this point, I was standing out in the hallway looking in on it, and I managed to stay there for part of it until they called me in. And I think at some point in here,
you get doused.
I get doused. It was
It
was a thrill, though. It was so much fun.
Yeah, it really looked like a lot of fun. Now, this wasn't the actual. Oh, there you are, right there.
Yeah, with
in the polo shirt,
Tony Kemp.
Yeah,
the wet shirt.
Yeah, the wet shirt. And so, this was not the national championship game, but the right to go to
exactly
the championship game, right?
Yes.
And so the championship game was not played here at Chancy Park. A little drinking there. He wasn't driving after. I don't think he was.
Actually, the funny thing about this is that once the celebration ended, the players had to go back and pack and be ready for a 1:30 a.m. pickup to take a bus to San Jose to get a flight that got them into El Paso on time. So the players took a real beating. They took a beating that day. And
right.
The worst part about that is that the press conference that they were rushing to attend was canceled because of weather in El Paso. So we could have had a leisurely flight, but instead the team had sort of a frantic few hours.
Right. And I want to talk over this. Tony Kemp made a couple of great catches out there to Chancy Park. He made a catch where he crashed into the wall. We can show that one first. And then a diving catch in the outfield. I believe it was left center field. What kind of contribution did Kemp give to your team?
Well, Kemp, first...
Look at this. Look at the first one. I believe he crashed against the wall on this one here. Yeah, he did. Yeah. Wow. Woo. Go ahead.
You have to understand that Kemp is about 5 foot. He's posted at 5 foot six.
Yeah.
And that would be a stretch for him to make it to 5 foot six. So
okay.
For him to reach up that high on the wall on the run, it was just an amazing play. But all of the players, the way the team gelled in the last 2 or 3 weeks was just beyond belief.
Wow, there it is again. Okay, let's get out of this one and get to the next one. That's a great catch. Go to the next one because he runs out, I believe, in left center field to make a grab there.
Yes.
You don't have to play this out till the end. Just go to the next one there. And then there it is right there. Kemp making a diving stab at the warning track. Look at that. That's pretty good, huh? Not bad for a little guy?
Not bad for a little guy.
So his contributions to the team were monstrous, to say the least, right?
They were, but he was one of about eight or nine, well, certainly the whole team, but eight or nine guys on our team last year who are just superstars.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
The good thing is that we had the superstars last year. The bad thing is that a couple of them are going to stick with Houston, so we won't be seeing Matt Duffy this year, hopefully, and we won't see Tyler White this year.
Yeah. So let me ask you, I'm looking here at some of the numbers. Mm-hmm. Let's see here if I can find my notes. I believe you average about 6,000 a game.
Correct.
You had about 450,000 go through the turnstiles for 2015.
Mm-hmm.
That's average for just about every year that the Grizzlies have played at Chancy Park.
Correct.
What did this championship do, if anything, to help boost the popularity of the team being here, of the stadium being here, to draw more fans in 2016? Did it do anything? Are season ticket sales up?
Okay, you have to follow the progression here. 2014,
okay.
The Giants won their world championship, and we lost the Giants.
Okay.
Now, picture that. Mm-hmm. And for us, we were very fortunate in that we've got a number of relationships throughout minor league baseball. And when we learned with certainty that the Giants were leaving, our friends over in Houston called up because they had lost their AAA team, and it was a great match. And I have fans who are coming to me now saying, I remember back to last October when we had the introduction to the senior staff at Houston, and that senior staff said, we are going to have a quality team in 2015. And most of the fans said, okay, we've heard that a lot from the Giants. It's just more of the same. When our season started, we were off on ticket sales. When people started to see the quality of team that we had and the quality of play on the field and the fact that we were winning, we bottomed out and started coming back. And by the time we hit the playoffs and made it through the playoffs, we had a net increase in attendance. Now, considering the drop-off and the recovery on attendance, I was really proud of what we did last year. Now, that propelled us, and the championship propelled us into a pretty good situation this year, in that our season tickets and group sales are both up. So we're expecting that we're going to have a pretty good improvement in ticket revenues in 2016. 2015 was pretty flat.
Did it, in your opinion, change the image of the team? Did it change the dynamics of people saying, I don't know if I want to go to a game. I don't know if I want to go down there at night to see a game. Do you think it changed anything in people's minds, Chris?
Well, ever since I arrived...
Talking about the championship now.
Right. Ever since I arrived in Fresno, I've heard people say that winning breeds success. And the unfortunate thing is we never won. So I could never test the hypothesis. This is the first time that we've had a winning team.
Yeah.
And I think it has made a difference. And I think people look at Houston and I guess last year there was a Sports Illustrated article that said that Houston should win in 2017. There was an article just recently that said that they were retracting that article and they were projecting Houston to be the winning team in 2016. They have a great team in Houston.
They had a pretty good team last year.
They did, but this year the team is better. They've got more strength. They've got some of our guys with them, and although we've lost some of our players, we've got some talent coming up from Lancaster and Corpus Christi who will more than offset that. So I think people do appreciate the fact that we've had a winning season last year, and I think it's going to make a big difference for us this year.
All right. We'll talk more with Chris Cummings right after this. He is the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. He's here to talk about baseball, the financial situation at the stadium and the team, and everything else under the sun. 436 MeTV, option 11. We encourage you to join the conversation, my friends, here on a Tuesday morning. Back in a moment.
Revan is now on KVHF channel 4.4.
Back here on the program, Tuesday morning, the focus is on business and talking to Chris Cummings about the championship season. And so this is the first time you've tested the waters with a winning team, that's true. And so what will change, before I get into the business topic of this program here, what will change next year at the ballpark? The team won, but you may not have the same faces there either. So is there going to be anything different to make it more exciting for fans to come to a game?
Well, again, we're a few of our players are moving to Houston and will be on the Houston roster, but the players that we have coming up from single A and double A will offset those folks. And we've got one player, AJ Reed, who's he is absolutely a monster of a human being. He's 6'4", 280 pounds.
First base.
He is absolutely immense, and his power is just beyond belief. So we've got him, we've got Singleton coming back, we've got Sclafani's coming back, Kemp's coming back, Fontana's coming back. So the heart of our lineup is going to be here, and then we've got the new players coming in. So I think you'll see a continuation of high level baseball and successful baseball. And then the thing that you can't remember is that our non-baseball portion of the business is the best in baseball. We won a number of awards last year on top of the national championship for the quality of the promotional events that we have at the ballpark and the type of promotional events. You'll see more of that, and you'll see better execution on that.
Right.
And I think overall, if you go to a game in 2016, you'll be happier and happier as the season goes on.
Okay, let me ask you some direct questions here.
Sure.
I think a lot of people out there want to know, what's your financial situation? Are you still looking for investors? Are you still looking to sell the team?
Well, yes to both. Yes to both questions. We are looking for investors, and if we can find somebody to buy the team, we will sell the team. And I'll tell you that this is the same status that we've been in for about the last 2.5 years. We did come close about 2 years ago with a gentleman who was interested, but some medical issues forced that to not proceed. We are talking to some people specifically right at the moment.
And investors or just outright buyers?
More than likely outright buyers. Whether it's
really
going to go through or not is still up for grabs, but we're talking to people.
How serious the talks are those?
They're pretty serious. People, they've come out, they visited, they've talked, they're looking at the financial records, and we've got a plan for them to look at as far as the future goes. So they're a strong candidate. Now, it's never over until the check clears, so we're planning on, and I'm planning on, being here for the rest of my life. And if somebody comes along, I'll do the best I can to make sure that it's a smooth transition. If nobody comes along, I'll look forward to continuing the collection of championship rings that I've started.
Right. Now, how long have you been in talks with this group or this individual?
This particular group, it's been about 45 days or so.
45 days.
Yeah.
And would you say it's, if there was a meter, okay, one way or the other, and straight up is 50%, would you say the talks were, in terms of seriousness, are they above the 50% mark?
They're above the 50% mark.
75? Not quite.
I'll stick with above the 50% mark, and don't try to pin me down, buddy.
No. So, how close are you to striking a deal? That's what I want to know. That's what everybody wants to know.
That's right what now. I want to know too.
Well, and you can't extract that information from them.
If I could, it would be pre-extracted, but it's difficult to extract something from somebody when you're a seller.
Right. Yeah. Right. So ongoing talks means you talk to them once a week, once a month. What's it like?
I'm talking to them probably 3 or 4 times a week now.
Wow, that's so pretty serious.
It's pretty serious.
That's above 50%.
Well, that's your definition above 50%.
Above
50%. That wasn't a quote from me.
Hey, but if you're selling a house, for God's sake, and you're talking to a potential buyer 3 times a week, that's pretty darn serious.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying there is a party with whom we're speaking, but until the check clears. You see, the process, it's not simply a matter of us finding somebody who's interested in buying the team. Okay, that's the first hurdle. The second hurdle is that the person or the group would have to be qualified by the league,
right?
By minor league baseball
and major league baseball.
By major league baseball,
yeah.
By the city of Fresno, And we would want to make sure that our good friends up at Chipchansey were comfortable, and our good friends with Heineken USA are happy with it. It's
so they not only have to pass the Chris Cummings smell test, they have to pass every other smell test with minor league baseball, major league baseball. They have to meet the criteria. And what, give us a couple of ideas what the criteria is.
Well, there are certainly financial criteria that are involved, and then there are also background checks, criminal checks, gambling checks.
Oh yeah.
You know, if you have even if you own stock or part owner of a casino, it's really not something that baseball's interested in doing. But really it's credit background, criminal,
and what your affiliation is with other people too, I'm sure.
Correct.
I mean, you know, and other business dealings you may or may not have that
correct
might be shady, that could not reflect well on baseball.
So
they want to keep the name clean.
They do, but you can be certain that we're not going to be wasting our time with somebody who won't be accepted by baseball. So before we invest our time in talking with people, we do a preliminary check on our own to make sure the people are good people with good backgrounds.
Well, let me ask you something. I mean, with all the excitement, and you've been here, you've owned the team for, I forget now, how many years?
10 and a half.
10 and a half years. That's a long time to own a team. You've been through the financial woes, up and down, and
still waiting for the ups.
Well, you had an up last year. You had a big up last year.
I'm teasing
but,
you, John.
But the thing is, here's the thing. I mean, you have such a glee on your face and in your eyes right now because of what happened last year. Why would you want to sell the team?
Well, really, from my perspective, if the team was operating well fiscally, I would never want to sell the team.
Okay.
But the fact of the matter is, because of a few certain things, some of which are related to our ownership group, it's going to be very difficult, if not impossible, for it to work right. So for me...
You mean for an extended period of time over the course of years?
Well, just as an example, the city last, I believe it was March, approved an amendment to the lease that would grant some relief, but that's contingent upon a new ownership group.
I see.
Now, if that relief were to accrue to me and my ownership group, that would relieve some of the economic pressure. The other thing that's happening this year is that our concessions agreement expires, and our concessions agreement wasn't a very favorable agreement for our ownership group. And a new concessions agreement is going to help the economics of the team. So
okay.
There are things that are happening that will make, and that's really the sales pitch to a new ownership group.
Oh, I see. And so we're going to continue our conversation. Got to take a quick break now. Chris Cummings, the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies, is here to talk about his team. And so I guess they're in serious talks. Who knows? The team could be sold anytime, my friends. We don't know. It might be above the 50% seriousness level here in terms of talks and sale. 436-ME-TV, option 11. If you want to call in and weigh in on this Tuesday morning, the business segment here on Connect With Me.
The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance. Enjoy generous-sized cooktops and sauté or simmer with ease, while true convection ovens offer even baking and juicy roasting perfection. Foods stay their freshest in spacious refrigerators with convenient controls and clear filtered ice and water. Easy-to-clean surfaces reduce fingerprints, and the quietest of dishwashers makes cleanup a snap. The new Frigidaire Professional line at Ventura TV Video Appliance.
You can find movies on Over the Air Channel 13.3. Movies. Our name says it all.
Back here with Chris Cummings, the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. If this deal goes through, negotiations with this group right now, you're talking to them, what, three times a week. If it goes through, would you possibly stay as a minority owner of the team?
That's yet to be negotiated and yet to be discussed. So right now we're trying to see if there's interest in them coming in to help me get some of my partners out. Now you have to understand though, our partners, when we put this together in 2005, had all amassed a certain amount of wealth.
Okay.
And to do that, you're typically not a 20-year-old person. They were all in their 50s and 60s back then. So a lot of those people are now in their 70s, and they're thinking about their estates and the future and making their lives a little bit simpler. And that's really the impetus behind the desire to at least change a portion of the ownership group.
Yeah, but you would like to stay as, say, a small minority owner if this happens?
If the opportunity presented itself, that's something that I would love.
Yeah, because it's exciting to be a part of it, obviously. You said you'd like to stay here for the rest of your life.
Absolutely.
In Fresno.
Absolutely.
And so let me ask you something that Holly Carter told me when she was here just not long ago. She's running for City Council District mm-hmm. 6.
Yeah.
She says that when the rent was reduced down to $700,000, that she was in on some of those negotiations. Now, that's what she told me. There's Holly right there. In her opinion, I'm not speaking for me, I'm speaking for Holly Carter, and I'm kind of paraphrasing what she said, and that is that the city of Fresno has done nothing or has made it difficult for you to do business here in the city of Fresno. They've done little to help you financially. They did cut your rent in half, but she said it was like pulling teeth, like giving a root canal, basically. Is that true,
well,
what she said?
No.
Has the city been?
No. Let's back up to when okay. that renegotiation happened. And
right.
this was when the economy in Fresno was in meltdown. It was, we were losing police, we were losing fire, we were
right.
having a difficult time keeping businesses open all over the city. And then along comes Cummings with a Grizzlies issue. And I think the city was absolutely as good as they possibly could have been. They were understanding with respect to my late lease payments, and I'll be the first to admit that the lease payments were always late. They were cooperative in coming up with a baseball consultant who helped define some terms that would help us. And since then, they have been the one area where there's been no pressure.
So you have no complaints about the city officials, the way you've been treated, or from Mayor Ashley Swearingen or Lee Brand? She told me Lee Brand doesn't even like baseball that much. So,
I can't really speak to Lee Brand's whether he likes baseball or not. I know he did come out a couple of years ago and threw out a first pitch and was
yep.
at the ballpark. But Lee is trying to balance, has been trying to balance being a city council member and also running an operating company, and that takes
yeah.
a lot of time.
Correct.
And it doesn't leave a whole lot of time for leisure activities. So I can't really say anything bad about Lee. Plus Lee was the person, and Larry Westerlund were the people who helped form the initial deal that was approved in 2010. Again, I
That's
can't
this
say-
this one now, $700,000 a year.
Correct.
And then Lee kind of led the charge
Lee led the charge, and I'll be the first to tell you that they were tough, and it was difficult. And I remember in I think it was late 2009 on Thanksgiving Day, I was in Petaluma, and I had to drive up to the top of a hill to have telephone conversations with Dan Barrett because the cell service was so bad. But all in all, the city has been as good as they could possibly be in dealing with a problem that came at the worst possible month of the worst possible year since Fresno was incorporated.
So you have no complaints about the city of Fresno?
None
or the
whatsoever.
Mayor.
None okay. whatsoever.
Well, I'm not sure what Holly was talking about then, because she made it very clear on this program not that long ago. But let's get to the Terrence Frazier issue, and we can put up a picture of Chick Chansey just beyond the center field fence there. There's a parking lot way out there in left center way out there.
Way out there.
And Terrence struck a deal with the city, where the city basically purchased this land for about $328,000 from the old redevelopment agency, and then they simply gave it to Terrence Frazier for $1. And so he had a lot of other breaks that added up to about $500,000 in tax breaks. And so it's way out there beyond that initial parking lot, way out there in the kind of the far top right corner. You see that open lot there? That's where he wants to build a high-rise business, retail. I believe on the bottom floor would be residential. It's quite a ways out there. Mm-hmm. How is that possibly going to help Chukchansey Park and the Grizzlies?
Well, that if you ask me if that one building structure is going to have a significant impact on us with 53 residential units, that one development will not.
But it'll be in five phases, though, with correct, all the development.
Exactly. That and we're talking right now about that first phase.
Yeah.
He also has the exclusive negotiating rights, if you follow the right-hand side of the screen down to our player parking lot. Mm-hmm. He has exclusive negotiating rights for that, and he also owns some land over on H Street.
Yeah, and over by Fulton Mall, too. And
correct.
So he's going to own a couple of buildings over there that he wants to kind of refurbish, and maybe, I don't know what he wants to do with them, but it'll be business, possibly retail. How will this enhance, in Chris Cummings' opinion, the Grizzlies, the stadium, in attracting people downtown?
By having some life down there. Now, if you remember back to 2005, there was a major plan that was being discussed in the city by Forrest, I think it was Forrest City out of Ohio, and they were planning on doing a major development down south of Inyo. And when we bought the team, we were thinking, oh boy, we're going to have 1,000 new residences and more commercial and retail. If you put people down there and life down there, more people are going to be interested in coming. And
that's the theory?
That's the theory. And it's worked well in other communities. So for me, this is really a small piece. This initial step by Terrence is really a small piece of the fulfillment of my dream from back in 2005 for residential development down in the in that area.
Here's the thing, though. I mean, when I'm not sure where you were in 2000 or 1999 when they were talking about this stadium issue, and I covered it when I was working as the main news anchor at KMPH. This whole baseball stadium thing and John Carberry. And Carberry was trying to push and push and push that we need the stadium downtown, and Sal Quintero was the key vote. It came down to his vote, yes or no. And the idea and the theory back then, think of how long ago this was to build residential and retail around the stadium. Here we are 15, 16 years later, they still haven't done it, Chris.
Yep.
The city hasn't done anything to promote downtown.
Well, but in fairness, if you look back at the last 7 years, where has the mayor been pushing development?
Has she done it in the right areas?
Well, if you're doing it in the right areas.
Well, but if you talk to Gary Bredefeld, the stadium is the crown jewel of downtown. So
correct.
If it's the crown jewel, then build around it.
Okay,
and build everything around it.
And that's where the base of Fulton Mall comes in. That's where Terrence's development
okay.
and future developments come in. If you want to look for another bright light in that area, it's Bitwise.
Oh yeah, Bitwise,
as a technology incubator.
Right.
Bitwise, and if you haven't had the Bitwise folks on your show,
we need
to get them.
Yeah.
If they can handle their plans and do what they hope to do, we will have a huge technology base operating in that part of the city, combined with Terrence's residential and the redeveloped Fulton Mall. And now you're beginning to talk about a place where the people on the north side might want to come down and visit.
Right, let's talk about the Fulton Mall and how that's going to enhance everything. So you have Terrence Frazier project, which won't be done for a while.
Correct.
That's down the road. All these things take time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, God permits this, that, and the other thing. So enter the Fulton Mall, They're going to open this thing up to traffic. How will that help?
Okay. Best case is that that opening up of that road alone will be a stimulant to having people want to move their businesses there. The worst case is that, and I think the worst case is actually a good case also, so much attention has been put in that part of the city and so many eyes are on it. And when people see dirt being moved and construction happening, and if you talk to the city and hear the amount of development that was contingent upon that, the opening of the mall, that is going to be a huge boost for us, because there are new buildings that are going to be cropping up. There are adaptive reuses of old buildings, and that alone is going to be a help for us. The more people who work and live down in that part of the city, the better off we're going to be, and the better off the city's going to be.
And so you think that these two projects, even though they're down the road a while, I think Fulton Mall is going to open in a couple of years. It's going to take a couple of years. And I think Terrence wants to time it so that at least for the most part, phase one is done in time to coincide with Fulton Mall. Mm-hmm. So we're a couple of years down the road, and then phase one, two, three, four, five is even further down the road.
Correct.
Let me get a direct question in here about the city.
Sure.
Has the city been wrong, in your opinion, in not facing this issue sooner? They should have started this 15, 16 years ago. Have they failed?
No, I don't. You know, it's easy to look back in history and declare failures for successes.
Yeah.
Hindsight is pretty simple. But again, in 2003, 4, 5, we had the Forest Cities coming down. They had their interest, and they were going to create enough movement so that it would allow for additional development. When that failed to happen, we had the economic recession. When that cratered virtually everything, all development in the city, or most development in the city, it took a while to recover, and now we're seeing the recovery. It was purely a case of bad timing, and yeah. I think everybody's now working to try to fix that and get the development that should have happened
15
started,
years ago.
Started,
Well, it's better than putting a lake downtown, like a certain mayor wanted to do a lot.
Don't talk to me about that, because I've seen that be successful in a lot of places across the country.
Putting a lake in the middle of downtown?
Not a lake, but a water feature.
Well, like I say a lake, but you know what I mean, like a pond or a big lake.
No, it's more of a river.
Yeah.
That could serve as a focal point for development, and it can be done for not a whole lot of money. And if you go to San Antonio and you go to their Riverwalk, tell me that isn't a worthwhile investment. You go to Oklahoma City, to Bricktown, tell me it isn't a good investment. It would have to
but
be done
properly.
But isn't
the better investment than that? Isn't it Terrence Fraser's project and perhaps Fulton Mall? Isn't it better than a Riverwalk?
We'll look back in 10 years and be able to make a determination. Yeah, and I'll be happy to come on the show in 10 years to talk about it with you.
We're happy to have you back. Don't wait 10 years though.
Okay. You've got my phone number, so
I know 436 Me TV option 11. I love it when Chris Cummings is here. He's the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. By the way, the home opener for the Fresno Grizzlies, can't mention this enough, is on April the 15th. I believe that's a Friday, and that's a tax day, right?
It's usually a tax day, but this year I think tax day is the 19th.
Oh, it is?
Because of holidays.
Holidays all over the place. Hey, that's good. Good to know. It gives me a little breathing space.
Absolutely.
436 MeTV option 11. Take a break and be back in a moment.
The following is another list of things you will not hear on MeTV programs. Man cave, baby bump, whatevs, double half calf mochaccino, faux hawk, redonkulous, totes, adorbs, hella, holla, YOLO, cray cray, and MeTV is still Kardashian free. This is what you will hear on MeTV programs.
Bang. Welcome, Denim. The Twilight Zone.
About wolves.
I object, Your Honor.
Mr. Grant.
I hear you right.
You heard me right.
MeTV. Thanks for listening.
Frigidaire. We introduce the first home freezer. The first pulsator agitator washer. And now we introduce the Frigidaire Orbit Clean Dishwasher, designed with a unique wash arm that gives you four times more water coverage for a consistently better clean. Frigidaire, over 90 years of legendary innovation. See the full line of Frigidaire appliances at Ventura TV Electronics and Appliances.
Back here on the program, let me ask you also, and we can roll some videotape of the AAA Championship. Let's roll that. We can talk over it a little bit here, Chris, and kind of enjoy this part of it too. Again, you know, you've been through so much financial ups and downs here the last 10 years or so. Why have you stuck with it? Is it your love of the game, love of the city of Fresno? What can we say is the main focus?
Well, I can tell you that it is a love of baseball. It is the fact that Fresno is an amazing place to live. And if you were to, at the end of the championship game, I was able to say a few words on national television. And I think my quote was that we are unapologetically Fresnan. I love this community. The people here are great. And our goal in the beginning was not to get rich from this baseball team. It was to provide safe places for children and families to go to be entertained. And it's been a struggle. It's been the most difficult job that I've ever had in my life. But I still wouldn't trade it for anything else. I wish it had been easier. If it had been easier, then I'd probably stay in this role until the day I died.
Yeah. Would you mind sharing Chukchansey Park with other teams, like say a pro soccer team? I know they'd have to probably readjust or make some adjustments to the stadium. That would cost money. But would you mind sharing it with say concerts? They haven't brought concerts here. You know, SMG controls many of these venues downtown, and they also control and run and operate the Save Mart Center. Mm-hmm. But it seems like all the big events, like Paul McCartney is going to Save Mart.
Yeah.
Why can't Paul McCartney come to the Chuck? Why can't Paul McCartney come to Celland or the convention center? Why does it always, all the good ones have to go out to Save Mart? It doesn't help stimulate downtown when they go out there.
True, but it's systemic. It's because of the facility. If you go to the Save Mart Center to do a concert, if you're a group, you walk in, you hang your soundboards, you hang your video boards from the superstructure that exists.
Right.
You plug into the power and you're ready to go. You can set up in a few hours. If you go to the ballpark, we've got to get staging imported. We've got to get soundboards imported, generators. It's difficult, cumbersome, and expensive. That being said, we are hopefully going to be announcing two concerts in September for brand name groups. We're still a couple of weeks away, but we're working on them. We had the Mexican Soccer League have a couple of their premier teams come up and play last week at the ballpark.
That was great.
We had one of the Armenian Premier League teams. They were good. They were a good team. We had them play. We have the Fuego playing their whole home season and hopefully their playoffs at the ballpark. I would love sharing it with a soccer group. Because we are already sharing it with a soccer group.
Yeah, the Fuego.
Yeah,
they're Fuego. And then there are a lot of times when there are high school football games that are played there during the fall.
Correct.
And, you know, I'm not sure who else would be willing to, you know, I'm talking about sharing the stadium and maybe sharing expenses. You know, the Fuego, though, is it the same? It's kind of the same ownership, though, right?
There are similarities in ownership, but there's not unanimity.
Gotcha.
So there's some overlap, and we're happy to share with anybody. We love the facility, and considering it's now what 14 years old, that is still one heck of a ballpark, and it's something that Fresno should be proud of.
And it'd be nice to get maybe a team in here that would share some expenses. I know. Hey, I've always wanted to ask you this question. Before we go, I know you're affiliated with Houston, and mm-hmm. maybe there's some Houston fans out there, and I don't want to offend anybody if you're a Houston Astros fan. I hope the Astros have a great season this year, as the Grizzlies, too. But how well did you get to know some of the Giants who won the World Series three years in a row? Like, for example, Brandon Belt, Buster Posey, Matt Cain was here. Who else was here? Lincecum was here. I can't think of... Who's that?
Panda.
Yeah, the panda was here for. Oh. No, the panda wasn't here.
For rehab.
Was he?
Yeah.
For rehab. Just mm-hmm. the rehab. How well did you get to know some of these players?
You know, we were able to get to know them. Really, it was more of a cursory relationship.
Okay.
But I'll tell you, the Houston guys are different, and it may
quickly tell us how different they are in terms of a relationship.
Well, I think one of the big differences with our Houston players is that as we were going through the playoffs and winning the division and winning the PCL, we were out celebrating with them, and you haven't developed a relationship with people until you've been out at 4 o'clock in the morning partying with them after a victory, and there's really nothing that can compare to that.
You never did that with the Giants, so
unfortunately, yeah. I was there for the World Series wins, but it's not the same. The access wasn't the same. But Derek and I were in the locker rooms for the championships. We were out with them afterwards, and we had the best. That it was the time of my life. It was one of the highlights of my life being around those guys.
So it's a better relationship with Houston.
With the players, it is.
With the players, it is.
It is.
Okay.
And I'll tell you, I walked into Yankee Stadium for the first playoff game, the winner
take
all. With the
Astros, yeah.
And this was back in October, and I was standing on the concourse, and John Singleton was on the field, and he was looking around. He was with Duffy, and they looked up, and they saw me, and both hands went up, and they were yelling and waving for me to come down, and it's a great relationship.
Take a quick call here, and then we'll go to our next guest. Go ahead, caller, quickly. You're on the air with Chris Cummings. Short on time, though. Short on time.
Quick question to the owner of the Grizzlies. They made a good choice in getting the Astros. Nobody knew about the Astros, and then they took the league and everything. And even in the National League, the Astros are going to be the up-and-coming young team. Even though Giants are there and Dodgers, whatever.
Yeah.
But the Astros are going to do well in the next 3-4 years. And that was, they have young players, and he did a great job bringing them here. And the people in Fresno will back up the team.
Okay.
They can want a winner. That's all they need. All we
Thank
need
you.
To do is get...
Thank you. There's a good positive call for you to end the show.
Absolutely. And he's right. And we're looking forward to an amazing season. And next season, I want to come back with our 2016 championship ring along with the 2016 Houston Astros championship ring.
Well, Chris, I'm glad you came on the program. Come back again. You're welcome here anytime. You know that, my friend.
My pleasure.
All right.
Thanks
Chris
a lot,
Cummings,
John.
Thank you for your time, the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. Back with our second guest here on Connect With Me in a moment.
When you're looking for KitchenAid innovation and quality, who has the answers, the selection, the price? Ventura TV Appliance. With billions in nationwide appliance buying power, more than Home Depot and Best Buy combined, we'll help you save. Our low prices on Energy Star qualified KitchenAid appliances save you energy and money, and pay no interest on select models when paid in full within 12 months. Ventura TV Appliance, serving you since 1951.
It's Sully and Russ on the Big Biz Show.
It's your biz.
And maybe they'll start listening to Baldwin McCullough.
Now, before you make any money moves, check in with the Brain Trust.
And you are starting your week off right. This TV is now on KDHF Channel 4.6.
You can find movies on Over the Air Channel 13.3. Movies. Our name says it all.
Everyone, this is Kev Orkian here, coming back live to Fresno on the 3rd of April 2016 at the Warner's Theatre. Now, guys, this is going to be a one-off. We've been working really hard. Ron and Barbara Mortanian have been going mental to try and get me back, and so have I. I miss you guys. I can't wait to see you. It's the 3rd of April at the Warner's Theatre. Get your tickets now. All you need to do is call Ron or Barbara, and they will have the details for you. Look after yourselves. See you soon. I can't wait.
Ron Mortanian is here. What would you call yourself? The promoter of this thing or what?
Semi.
Semi-promoter.
Yeah, Lucy is the promoter. I'm giving Lucy. Well, it's her gig.
What are you? Are you a tag along or what?
Yeah, I'm just support.
All right. I got four tickets here and it comes up. This says Me TV on the back. Why am I giving these away? They belong to me. No, they don't. Anyway, hold that up. So I got four tickets here to see Kev. He's a comedian. He's a pianist. He's a big-time comic. He's big overseas. I'm talking in England, over there across the pond, my friends. He's huge over there. And he's coming here to Fresno for what, the second or third time?
Third time. Yeah, third time.
All right, third time's a charm,
third
right?
Third time's a charm.
So it takes place on Saturday at the Warner's Theater. What
Sunday.
Time?
Sunday?
I'm sorry, Sunday.
Yeah.
Is it April 3rd? It's April 3rd, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
All right, and these are worth $45. You want two free tickets, we'll give them away here. Just call 436-ME-TV, option 11. So Ron, tell us a little bit about Kev.
Kev is a world-class pianist. He started when he was 3 years old. He's phenomenal, he's hilarious. We've seen him in Vegas. We've seen him on cruise ships. He's gonna be on the world's largest cruise ship next year, the Royal Caribbean. He just got back from Boston. He's done Las Vegas. He's done Africa. He's done everywhere. And now they're courting him at the Bellagio, I hear. That's kind of a secret.
Oh, really?
So maybe next year we might go to Vegas to see him at the Bellagio. So it's an opportunity of a lifetime for the people in the Valley to get to see someone of this extreme talent. He is amazing and such a friendly person, too.
All right, where can people call? I see you have there's the poster right there, Kev Orkian. Oh, we have a caller right now that's calling in at 436-ME-TV, optional. Only have 2 minutes left. Caller, you're on the air, go ahead.
Yes, is that tickets? This is
right here.
Edward. And are those tickets still available?
Yep, two free tickets
couple
for
of
you.
Them maybe?
For Sunday. Do you want to go see Kev? I'll give them to you.
Okay.
What's your first name? I'm sorry.
Edward.
Edward, I'll leave him here with Michelle. How's that?
Okay, you got it. Or I got it. thank you.
Yeah, make sure and pick him up. We close every day of the week, except for Sunday. We close at 6 o'clock.
Probably be there tomorrow.
You got it. Thank you, Edward.
Okay. Hey, thanks. Okay,
hope
again,
you have fun.
Thank you. You're welcome.
All right, so two down, two to go, 436-ME-TV, option 11. A little more about that phone number you have in front of you there. Go ahead, Ronnie, hurry.
Oh, please call Lucy if you can't get a hold of me at 284-8678.
Okay, you want to hold that up to that camera? You can, right there, 284-8678. That's
right
like
there.
The old days when before graphics, right?
Yeah, 284-8678, ask
who is
for
she?
Lucy.
Who is she?
She's in charge of the event, and I'm her assistant. I like to
why
be her
Warner's
assistant.
Theater?
Because we wanted something different this time. And Warner's Theater is one of five of the original theaters that are left.
One of the best venues in the Valley.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And it's phenomenal. The seats are wonderful. Every seat is fantastic. And it's just a beautiful place. And the parking is free all over the town because it's Sunday. And so the parking is lax, so you can park anywhere.
Yeah.
But
so we have
miss it. You don't
30
want to miss
seconds
this.
Left, and how are ticket sales going? Quickly,
good.
About 30 seconds.
The VIP section is already gone. Now we're selling the reserved. I mean the general. And
are these VIP tickets?
Those are general.
Those are general.
Yeah, the sponsors got the VIP or the reserved.
Okay.
And so the generals are available, and we have people coming from Los Angeles that said hold a bunch of them too. So we're holding quite a few for them. And it's going to be fantastic. Don't miss it. Sunday, April 2nd at 2. Doors open at 1:30.
Wait a minute. I thought it was April 3rd.
Did I say 2nd? I'm sorry, April 3rd. Yeah, it's April 3rd. I made a mistake. April 3rd, the doors open at 1:30, and the show begins at 2:30, and it lasts till 4 o'clock.
Okay, so that's this Sunday, Warner's Theater. Ron, got to run. Got to learn. We promoted that thing, baby.
We did.
We pushed it, and we gave 2 free tickets away. That means somebody's watching.
Oh, they didn't get the other ones, huh?
No, they didn't, but they will. Okay. But they will. 436, Mean TV, option 11. We'll give them away maybe tomorrow. Who knows? We'll see you back here on Connect With Me. Have a good day.